Thank you both for coming in. The Columbian is pleased to welcome candidates for Secretary of State. Tina Podlodowski.
It was perfect. Thank you.
And Kim Wyman. I'm Greg Jane, the editorial page editor here. And I believe you met the other board members. And just so you know, Lauren Dake, reporter, is sitting in on this, taking notes. She won't be asking questions here, but might want to speak with you afterwards.
Okay.
And the final bit of housekeeping is we are videotaping this. We'll post it on our website unedited, as we do with all of our editorial board meetings, for the benefit of our readers. So we will start with some introductions. Go ahead, take 1 to 2 minutes. Tell us a little bit about yourself, your background, and why you are running for this particular position. We'll start with Tina.
Sure. I mean, for me, it's all about making sure that we've got a voting system that in Washington State that's equitable for everyone. You know, I think we really differ in terms of perspective in looking at this race. The status quo and everything's fine, I think, is the perspective that Kim comes from, and mine is change must happen. You know, here in Washington State, over the last 4 years on her watch, we've seen voter turnout decline every year that she's been Secretary of State. We've got over 1.6 million people who are eligible to be registered to vote who've not been registered to vote. In fact, she's registered less than 100,000 of them during her tenure as Secretary of State. And of course, there's been no effort to look at equity across the state in so many big policy issues. I've got a 30-year track record of working on these kind of systemic issues and doing so with an eye towards equity during my time as an executive at Microsoft, where I ran businesses in the U.S. and outside of the U.S., during my time as a Seattle City Council member, and then also during my time running quite large nonprofits here in the state of Washington. All of those perspectives, government, business, nonprofit, are part of the job of Secretary of State. So I come with a level of qualification and management skill that certainly hasn't been demonstrated in the last 4 years. The last piece of this is technology. The biggest issue that's going to face the Secretary of State in the next 4 years is using technology. And as we've seen, certainly in the last few weeks, around our ability to find and fix something in the voter database that has been sitting there since 2012, and the Secretary has not done anything about, well, there's issues related to technology and cybersecurity. There's issues related to the lawful use of things like the Secretary of State's Twitter account. It's a brand new issue. So all of those things, I think, require someone who understands that level of top technology, but a commitment to the voters of the state of Washington. I believe the job of Secretary of State is to make sure 100% of the people who are eligible are registered and 100% of people are voting. If that's your goal in the job, then you will change the way the office currently works dramatically, and you'll do everything you can to reach that goal.
Thank you. Kim?
So I had a career-defining moment many years ago where my husband and I received our absentee ballots the day after an election when we were overseas and he was in the Army. And a few years later, in 1993, I became the election supervisor in Thurston County. And I made a commitment to myself that every voter in my charge would have their voting rights protected, and I'm proud to tell you that I've done that every day since. Elections are a public job interview, and I encourage you to compare our resumes, compare our leadership experience, and compare our endorsements. I have really approached elections as a profession. Became a certified, nationally and state certified election administrator. I've conducted over 100 fair and accurate elections and earned a reputation not only for my impartiality, but also for my innovation. And that's why I've been invited to serve on hundreds of panels and work groups, conferences, not only trying to improve elections in Washington State, but doing it on a national level. In 25 years, I've held 4 positions that are directly related to the job I'm currently seeking. When you compare that to my opponent's resume, in that same period of time, she hasn't kept a job longer than 4 years. When you look at the track record, before 9 months ago, she hadn't visited most of the counties in the state. She hadn't walked into an elections department or even observed an election. She's been a political activist. Finally, compare our endorsements. When you look at our endorsements, I've got a diverse range of not only individual endorsements, but organizational endorsements. That includes Democrats, Republicans, Independents. It includes organizations from the WEA to the Association of Washington Business, from the Seattle Times to the Tri-City Herald. And I think the essential question in this election is, who do you trust to instill public confidence in our elections? Someone who's been an election administrator and impartial and have demonstrated experience doing that, or someone who's been a partisan activist?
Great, thank you. We'll move on to specific issues. We'll start with Kim. Where does the state stand on the Voting Rights Act, and where should we go?
The state, well, I can tell you where I stand on the Voting Rights Act. There was a horrible video that I actually did here in Clark County about 4 years ago that had me saying no, that I was against the Voting Rights Act. And I was against that 2012 version of the Voting Rights Act because it had systemic problems, mainly with how you could conduct an election and how the county auditors had timing, had enough time to do things like redraw district lines. So that's why I opposed it, and that's why in 2013, when I became Secretary of State, I started working behind the scenes with staff and with legislators to improve the bill. And you know, that bill couldn't get out of the House and Senate or get signed by the governor in a year when the Democrats controlled all three chambers. So, you know, the bill had said problems, and it's had, and it certainly is a partisan divide in the last four sessions. And I really do believe that I'm the only person in this race that could bring both sides together to have those tough discussions and get that bill to a point that we could get it passed. We've been working, we have a bill drafted that we're going to drop in 2017 to really start that conversation and try to see if we can get the Voting Rights Act to move forward.
Thank you. Tina?
Well, I think it's only a horrible video because it's true. Kim opposed the Voting Rights Act in 2012, and as Secretary of State, she has not done a thing in the last 4 years to get the Voting Rights Act passed. She hasn't made it part of Secretary's request legislation. She hasn't worked with the state legislators who have been the prime sponsors of the bill for the last 4 years to make that happen. She claims that she's the one to bring people together around this particular issue, but the party is her own Republican Party. And obviously, as a Republican Secretary of State, she has not been able to move the dial with Republicans in any way, shape, or form on the Voting Rights Act. So I think it's rather disingenuous to talk about that. She also, if you go back and look at the public record, there's nothing there in terms of Kim's work on this particular bill. The Voting Rights Act is something that I support, I've strongly supported through this. Heck, Kim mentioned earlier that I've recently come to this. Well, I was working on equity issues back in 1993, running statewide campaigns with every county in the state of Washington around this. So it's really interesting for Kim to suddenly say, after 4 years of absolutely nothing, that she supports the Voting Rights Act. She doesn't. And in 2012, when she said it didn't pass, when we had a majority of Democrats in there, well, the reason it didn't pass is because there were 30 different riders that the Republicans tried to put on that bill, and it could not get off the floor in time. So let's be real. You can't make up 4 years of history around something that you've done nothing to work on and suddenly say you support it.
Did you support the 2012 version of it?
For me, yes. I think that there was an opportunity to get that passed and work out the issues administratively. So I think that we should have done it back in 2012. We've seen the cost of what's happened. Yakima spent $3 million defending a lawsuit related to the Voting Rights Act and implemented districts anyway. Pasco is now under a consent decree with regard to that, and you'll start to see Wenatchee and other cities fall into place around it. It's a simple equity issue. So it's something, again, that I think demonstrates a definite difference between the two of us.
You know, you both already have talked about party differences and partisanship. Why is and should this even be a partisan position? Shouldn't Secretary of State be beyond party? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I think the job of Secretary of State when you're in office is to be beyond party and to make sure what you're doing is absolutely fair and absolutely honest. I think if you look at the way that it is as an office right now, when we run as Republicans and Democrats, it really tells you who the person is and the perspective that they come from. Look, I'm proud to be a Democrat. Democrats are the party of the Voting Rights Act. Democrats are the party of equality and making this happen. I think it's really clear, if you look at all the things that I stand for, things like, again, the VRA or automatic voter registration, same-day registration, pre-registration for 16 and 17-year-olds and postage-free ballots, that it's incredibly important for me to have this office be one where everyone, whether you're a Democrat or a Republican or an independent, has an opportunity to register and an opportunity to vote. I think that that's one of the differences. You know, the Secretary says she's nonpartisan, but geez, even yesterday her office is tweeting puff pieces about Bill Bryant on the official Twitter account, which is against the law. That's not okay, and that shows partisanship.
And we'll get into that. I'm curious, do you have much support from Republicans throughout the state?
Sure. You know, if you take a look at the Republican Party throughout the state,
do you have any endorsements from Republicans?
I have endorsements from individuals who are Republicans. I don't have endorsements from party operatives who are Republicans in making this happen. I think, you know, Republicans have controlled this seat for 52 years in Washington State. It's one they do not want to get rid of, they want to hold it. And I think it's important to take that into the context about the race.
Kim, should this be a partisan race?
I think that the reason it's a partisan race, particularly in our state where you don't have party registration, I think you look at legislators who want to have a quick and easy count, how do the statewide offices break? I think that's the fundamental reason why we still have it. It's easy to kind of draw lines around that. But you know, it's really critical that once you walk in the door every day, that you're impartial. And I have a demonstrated track record of that. I've done it for over 23 years, and I'm very proud of that. We've seen in other states, when you have a very partisan Secretary of State, it has an eroding effect on voter confidence. We've seen it in, you have examples. The best example, of course, is 2000 with Katherine Harris, when she was chairing George Bush's campaign, and the race came down to that state. People to this day would tell you that they either believe he was elected or they believe the election was stolen. So it's really critical. You look at California, we had a very partisan Secretary of State there for 8 years, and they are 10 years behind meeting a federal requirement for having a statewide voter registration database. The current secretary is about to put it in place. But that's because we had a partisan secretary who really focused on a handful of very narrow issues to try to move forward an agenda, and the state suffered as a result. So it's very critical, I think, that it's how you do the job. And that's really what I'm running on, is this long record of doing these things. So, you know, Tina's pointed out all these things that she's for. These are ideas that have been around for 4 or 5 sessions. And they are all ideas that we've worked on. You know, I sat before the Sed board a year ago and talked about automatic voter registration. And a bill that we had sponsoring. We have some dramatic differences between Oregon and California, so our bill's different. We fought for 17-year-old pre-registration. I'm working with Congressman Denny Hick to see if we could do something around postage paid return envelopes, because it's a federal issue. As you know, we have a postmark requirement in our state, and if you have postage paid return envelopes, they don't postmark those, and we wouldn't be able to tell if the ballot was valid or not. So, you know, these are complex issues. It's easy to cherry pick a handful of things, talk about them very narrowly, memorize a couple bits of data, but when you actually start talking about the layers that go into it, it's not just about status quo. It's about, you know, federal law that we have to comply with. You know, for example, the 1993 National Voter Registration Act. That act was passed into law before we had the internet. But we still have to comply with all of the paper requirements of that law. So, I mean, it's a complex job.
And do you have support from Democrats?
I do. I have a wide support. I have county auditors and election directors, Democrats, Republicans, Independents. And I'm proud of the Democrats we're starting to pick up. We picked up Pierce County Auditor Julie Anderson, who has not endorsed anyone in 7 years. And she was so outraged by the campaign that she endorsed me. I just picked up one of my opponents from 4 years ago, Jim Castema, who's a Democratic senator. So, you know, we're earning that through the way we're running the campaign.
Well, to be honest with you, this is a difficult race for me, only from the standpoint that there aren't, for me, and I think the average voter, this is a difficult race to try to hook issues to. For example, Tina said that voting has gone down for however long it's gone down. I mean, how much of an issue, how much blame should be given to the Secretary of State's position for voter downturn?
I think a lot. I think that that's where the buck stops. You know, the Secretary of State's office is a constitutional office. I don't think the framers of the Washington State Constitution put that office in there to be a clerk. I think they put it in there to be an advocate for voters in Washington State and to make sure that it's a voting system where people indeed have every opportunity to register and every opportunity to vote. 6 out of 10 people in Washington State do not vote. And for the last 4 years, the Secretary's really been absent in making that happen. She talks about sort of the smokescreen of like federal rules, but one of the things she doesn't talk about is the Secretary of State's need to have oversight over those county auditors and the work that they're doing at the county level and those county systems. The reality is we don't have one voting system in Washington State. We have 39 systems based on the 39 counties. They're funded differently, they're staffed differently, that we don't have a uniform ballot across Washington State, and there has never been an equity audit to really understand the numbers that we can work from as a baseline in terms of changing our voting system and getting people to turn out and seeing what all of the issues are. The issues are granular issues. They're issues at the remote level. That's why I've spent time in all 39 counties talking with voters over the last 9 months to be able to do that. I'll tell you one example up in Nia Bay, someplace the secretary's never been, talking to the Macaw tribe there on the reservation. You know, the Macaw vote at 98% in tribal elections, 17% in statewide elections. You ask the question, why? Why is that? Well, it's because they have been asking for a drop box on the reservation. It's one of the poorest places in the state of Washington. Clown County has all of 3 drop boxes. So, I said a drop box, well, it's like $1,200, $1,500 for a drop box. Why can't we get you a drop box? And they laughed and they said, you know what? We've been asking for a drop box for 10 years. So if you get elected and you can get us a drop box, well, we'll do a celebration over that particular issue.
Yeah, but wouldn't that be a county issue?
You know what? It's a county. If the county's not performing on that issue, then the person whose responsibility it is to make sure that things are happening is the Secretary of State. The county auditors are indeed separately elected officials, and they truly are the ones who count the votes. That's why, unlike my opponent, I made the decision not to go after county auditors' endorsements. She's a former county auditor, has been one for a number of years. I'm looking at shaking up the status quo. That's a pretty closed system and a pretty closed group of folks when it comes to that. But I also think county auditors should never endorse and never be asked to or even pressured to endorse in any kind of race. That's one way to ensure trust in the system. But as Secretary of State, if voters are having a problem and the county's not dealing with it, it's my job to figure out the different ways to fix that. That's something the Secretary's been absent for the last 4 years, in identifying those problems, getting a baseline of numbers and issues and concerns, and then systematically working through it to make sure that people are voting.
You know, and one thing I want to go back on, and you mentioned the voter turnout in the state.
Mm-hmm.
How does that compare to other states?
You know, some of the states are worse, some of the states are better. You know, here in Washington
State.
So
how can we blame that on our Secretary of State if other states are having the same problem?
You know what, I have 3 kids. And what I tell my kids is, if somebody else gets an F in class, that's no excuse for you to get an F in class either. You know, under previous Secretaries of State who were Republican, like Ralph Monroe and Sam Reed, there were innovations here in Washington State. There hasn't been on the Secretary's watch. There has been innovation right across the river, though. With somebody who supports me, Governor Kate Brown, when she was Secretary of State, to do automatic voter registration, 220,000 new voters, and a whole host of other things.
And we'll yep. get to that. I'm sorry, yep. What was Lou's question?
Yeah. So voter turnout is going to go up if you get elected?
Yes, we will work on voter turnout, and the buck has to stop somewhere. I believe it's the Secretary of State's office.
And you'll take the blame.
And I will take the hit 4 years from now.
When it continues to go down like it does.
I will take the hit 4 years from now,
so
yes.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So how much of a blame should you take for turnout?
Well, one of the things that I'm very proud of is I've always been and operated in a very transparent way, and I definitely take ownership when things don't go the way that they're supposed to. So, you know, let's start with voter turnout. It's, first of all, a false narrative to deflect from the resident experience. So let's talk about voter turnout. You know, voter turnout is a 4-year cycle. It peaks in a presidential year, it goes down a little bit in the midterm, and it's at its lowest in the odd year elections. And this is not only a trend that you see in our state, you see it nationally. And further, we've spent the last 20 years, this board is well aware of it, of bringing in all sorts of innovation, not only in this state, but other states, of voting centers and absentee ballots and then moving to vote by mail. And all of those were under the premise that our voter turnout was low and we need to do something to make it easier to vote, make it more accessible. We've done all those things, and what's interesting is if you look at that pattern, it hasn't changed. There has been a gradual decline in participation that's on a national level, and I'm proud to tell you, when you actually look and compare other states, we actually lead the country in turnout. We're among the highest states. In 2015, which was one of the years that Tina chose to attack because we had a 38% turnout, you're right, that was low, and it was very disheartening. But you look nationally, the average was 28%. Some states were down to 18%. So it is a bigger picture discussion, and when you look at, you know, easy to throw out all the things that I haven't done and how poorly I've done them, that's easy attack. But let's drill down. So I'll give you one example. 3.5 years ago, two, three years ago, I convened a work group. It was a tech summit, and we were trying to address all of these voting systems that each county has. Each county has its own voter registration management system. They have to work with our state database system, and they've all built all sorts of layers to do, you know, better service to their customers, provide better service to their customers. And so we sat down, and I asked a fundamental question. If you knew now what you knew 10 years ago, if you knew 10 years ago what you know now, would you build the system we have? Not a single hand went up. And so from there, we started this dialogue, and we started looking at not only what are our voters asking for, what services are we not able to provide, what things can we not do, but take it a step further. How are we going to fund this? How are we going to make it equitable for all 39 counties? How are we going to make it so that a voter in Clallam County has the same experience as one in Asotin or one in King? And so we've approached this very comprehensively. We have a plan. We did a request for information just to see if that was even doable, because this is unprecedented. No other state has done this. The private sector has told us it's doable. Now we have an RFP that we're getting ready to release with the actual specs for the system, and then we hope to select vendors and install next year. We have to go to the legislature for funding, of course. But with all of that said, you know, that we do look at all these things comprehensively, and we are working to make sure that every voter's experience across the state is the same.
Well, I'm sorry. I just have to say, if you talk about transparency, so where is that financing plan? I haven't seen one. Where is that equity audit? You're just repeating my talking points about what I'm calling for because it's work that you haven't done. And if you actually go through and read the spec, that's there in terms of the technology component, this is basically not something that's forward-looking or anything that took into account talking to voters and the need in voters in Washington State. If you build, another insular system, which is what happened 10 years ago, you're going to have the same kind of results 10 years from now. And let's talk about innovation. Number one, none of the innovations that you've talked about happened on your watch. They happened on the watch of previous secretaries of state. And let's talk about voting as well. The Northwest Progressive Institute did a great comparison of the previous four-year cycle to this four-year cycle, and every year that you've been in office, voting turnout has gone down. It's gone down 17%, it's gone down 15%, it's gone down 9%. Cumulatively, that's a lot.
But again, isn't that a national trend?
Doesn't matter that that's a national trend. Again, would you put the same standard in terms of Jay Inslee and what happens in another state? You've got to do your job as Secretary of State. You've got to make the changes that work within your state and do the work to look at those issues to make it happen. I believe that it hasn't happened, and I believe that it needs to be data-driven. You can't do anything or get the legislature to do anything unless you actually have the data to show what happens and build the relationships in the legislature. Kim's had 4 years to do that and has not turned over a single significant piece of legislation. I do believe it's time for somebody else to come in, have a different approach, a very voter-centric approach in making this happen, and do the work to make sure that we've got a system that works. The last thing, I want to talk about is the transparency component of it. Where is all of this data? It's not there. You can't find it anywhere on the Secretary of State's website. And at a national level, places like the Pew Charitable Trust, they do the Election Performance Index, matching state by state in terms of their election performance, which is started. We were number 12 in the country. Now we're number 20. I think that's important to put out there.
Okay, so let's work backwards. So the reason that the Pew Performance Index exists is about 8 years ago, a group of election administrators, I was one of the ones that was called from the counties, and academics and people from across the country came together and wanted to improve elections nationally. And one of the things we were most concerned about is that if you started ranking states, it would be used politically, so we were right. But let's talk about what that ranking means. So Washington has been very consistent in the 3 years that we've done the ranking. We do it every 2 years. And we've been right about 71%, and I'm really proud of that. We are one of the highest states, and we lead the country. We've had a number of innovations as a state that make other states better. And so going from 12 to 20 means that 8 states caught up with us. 8 states have gotten better. 8 states have added online registration. 8 states are doing things that are much more innovative. So I'm proud of that, and we could manipulate our numbers. There are some things we could do. For example, we could go through every presidential election and wipe out all of our military overseas voters and make them reapply. we keep them on the rolls, and so that actually makes our return rates look worse, but we want to make sure that we're giving every voter a chance to participate. Working back on turnout, when you look at that four-year cycle, let's talk about that. So 2010, we had 71% turnout in the general election, and it was substantially lower in 2014. The difference between those two elections was what was on the ballot. You'll remember 2010 had three taxation issues. It had the soda pop tax, it had income tax, and it had the two-thirds majority for the House and Senate to pass tax increases. That's part of what drives turnout, is what's on the ballot. The second thing is whether voters think that their vote matters, if it's going to make a difference. If they don't think it is, they don't vote. And I think the third thing is, and we're certainly seeing this at a national level, is the nasty politicking. People attacking each other, people taking shots, people doing all this. After a while, voters get very sick of it, and they just unplug and detune. So turnout is more complex than just whether or not I got people to vote, and it is a partnership with the counties. It's not just the counties, but the counties are integral partners. You know, one of the things that Tina has been hammering me on the trail is the ceremonies at the immigration ceremonies when people become naturalized citizens. You know, we are present at many of those, but I don't want to overstep my bounds with the county auditors. And they are the ones on the front lines. They're the ones responsible for voter registration. They're the ones who are interacting directly with their constituents. And we always kind of give them the pass and the first chance to do that. But we do go to them, and we are involved with them.
Well, just one sort of thing, which is your narrative about what's on the ballot doesn't hold up. When you look at the years where we had things like marriage equality, we had marijuana, we had Tim Iman initiatives, and still turnout went down. 2010 was not on your watch. Let's be clear about that. So again, that's down when you have those things on the ballot, and it has consistently gone down under your watch.
So Tina mentioned that mm-hmm. on the Nia Bay, there's no drop box mm-hmm. there. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, whose responsibility is that?
Ultimately, it is the county auditors, I think that a lot of these attacks that are coming my way really show one of two things, either a complete lack of knowledge of the job and the scope and scale of the job, or trying to bring a real partisan dialogue to it. I'm not sure which it is, both are alarming. So when we talk about places like Nia Bay, and when I was in Thurston County, it was the Evergreen State College. Why isn't there a drop box on the Evergreen State College? And you can cherry pick all sorts of spots around the state where, you know, why don't we have a drop box in this spot? And both sides could do it, and they can make all sorts of arguments. The auditors ultimately are responsible for citing those, and it is about data-driven decisions. You know, I think your auditor has a very different approach than some of his colleagues around the state, but he has reasons for it, and those are his to own. You know, that this idea that going around the state and visiting 39 counties and talking to a handful of people in each county is reflective and is stronger and better than what the county auditors are doing is kind of ridiculous, because the county auditors, one, have to get reelected, so they have to know what their constituents want, and they have to reflect those values, and they have to be performing to get reelected. They are the ones making those decisions on the ground and on the front lines. And, you know, I'm proud to tell you that our county was the first county in the state to have drop boxes. We're the one who brought this program together, and it was before we were ever vote by mail. The two complaints I got every election when we did a vote by mail election, you remember the 90s, we could do certain elections by mail, was poll tax was a stamp, and that they didn't like their signature being visible to their postman. And so what we started to do is we had staff drop sites. And they were super popular, and we had them kind of in key locations where we had the biggest poll sites. And then eventually we turned those into 24-hour, 18-day window open drop boxes, and those have worked fantastically. When I left Thurston County, we had more drop boxes than King County did, and Thurston is a tenth of the size. So, you know, to just blanket say that Nia Bay doesn't have one because I haven't done my job is very misleading.
I just want to respond very quickly to that, which is, Nia Bay is just one example of that, and it's not an attack to point out lack of performance. I think it's Kim portraying it as an attack being defensive because of that lack of performance. And there's no partisan issue here in terms of looking at voters' accessibility to the ballot box, hence doing the 39-county audit and looking at this from a very numbers basis and understanding the equity component of what's happening here. You also have a responsibility as Secretary of State to help county auditors do their job, to get the funding that they need to do their job. You know, the state does not pay its fair share, particularly in presidential years. even years of elections. And there has to be comprehensive funding to look at that. That, again, is part of the role of Secretary of State. Secretary of State also has a statutory component where you need to be auditing these county auditors as well. So it's a very interesting balance in terms of your ability to help people do the job, as well as being critical and auditing to do the job. Again, that's why I think it's important that the Secretary of State do not go after endorsements from these folks. It's like going after endorsements from people in a very sort of interesting relationship sort of thing, where it doesn't matter, where you need to be critical on the one hand, you need to be helpful on the other hand to work through it. But to say that pointing out issues where performance simply hasn't happened is an attack, or that that's partisan, that that doesn't fly.
So, Tina, do you have any endorsements from any of the auditors, state auditors?
No, I deliberately said I would not go after any of the state auditors and ask them for their endorsements. I didn't think it was proper for the Secretary of State to do that. I think you have to hold yourself in a different position and a different level of accountability in making that happen. And it puts undue pressure on the auditors, particularly if you're the incumbent, to endorse you.
Tina, you mentioned Oregon's motor voter bill has increased the rolls.
Yeah.
But in Washington, we don't require citizenship for a driver's
license. Yeah.
So how do you reconcile that?
Well, you know, in 2018, we've had three bites at the apple with the feds to get Real ID implemented here. In 2018, that's the last one. So we're going to get to that point in terms of making that happen. So I think that, first of all, there needs to be a work group now about those issues, and the Secretary of State, again, should have taken leadership here to work on those issues about how do we deal with DOL and licensing, and then the subsequent issues related to voting to make that happen. In California, they have a two-tiered license, citizens, non-citizens. They're implementing automatic voter registration based on that two-tier license. So it's definitely something that can be done, and certainly we should be doing here in Washington
State.
So
if we do get Real ID, then you think then that should automatically
And in the meantime, I will give Kim credit for doing, in the last session, coming up with commercial driver's licenses as a way to do automatic voter registration. Senator Jayapal, a Democrat, someone who's endorsed me, came up with the health benefits exchange as a way to get more people registered because you're proving citizenship there. So, you know, I give credit where credit is due in making that happen, but more should be ready and done in the works to get us to that place.
Kim, what do you think about the motor voter?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it's something we were certainly watching California and Oregon do, and we started having conversations in our office, and the stumbling block really became the proof of citizenship step, because our state, as you know, doesn't check citizenship at time of driver's licensing. So we were going along, and one of my staff had said, you know, maybe we could do enhanced driver's license and commercial driver's license, because citizenship is a part of that process. And I kind of said, yeah, I'm not comfortable with that, because that's really people that have the money to do one of those two things. And it wouldn't be as balanced as I'd like to see it. And then it was Senator Jayapal that approached us and said, what about adding the health benefits exchange? So that was a great bill. And it was interesting, because I got the biggest pushback from my own party. It got out of the House. It did not make it out of the Senate. And my argument to them always has been, one, every Republican room I've been in since I took office as auditor has kind of beat me up on, why don't you check citizenship for voter registration? And we've got a whole other discussion on that. So my whole thing was, we could verify all four elements of voter registration: citizenship, residency, whether they were under the supervision of Department of Corrections, and whether they were over 18. Why wouldn't we register those people if we could actually verify those? And so I'm still hoping, and we'll bring that bill back in 2017, I'm still hoping we can get that through. And then we can actually start incrementally bringing in automatic registration and kind of find out what works and what doesn't, and fine tune it. So if the legislature does expand citizenship checks to all driver's licenses, then we'll be able to roll it out for the whole state.
We recently had a situation of data being exposed.
Mm-hmm.
What happened there?
Uh-huh.
What was done to fix it?
So back in December, we had a really difficult decision to make. We realized that our My Vote application, which is essentially a voter can get very specific information that's unique to them, was not accessible. And one of the rules I've had, longstanding rules I've had, is we don't take any kind of upgrades or make any big changes in a presidential year, because the risk is high. But we knew that this was very important. We wanted to make sure that a blind voter could take that application and read it with a screen reader. So we took the risk, we went ahead and updated that application and made it accessible. And about a week ago, when is today, Thursday, exactly a week ago, on Wednesday, we were notified by the cybersecurity office for the state that that Tina had notified them that they were able to see the script behind the webpage. They have the beautiful part of the webpage that we all see. Well, the text and the script that goes behind that, the developer code, was visible. Someone, you know, who had the programming skills or hacking skills or whatever to get to see that, went behind and saw that, and they found four fields. So they found phone number, email, the voter's ballot status or ballot type that was sent, and their military status. And so those are four codes that are not defined in statute as part of the voter registration database, but I would remind you that those are readily available in a lot of other places. So so thanks to Tina, we immediately made sure that that coding was secured. And then we, you know, we let the public know and tried to be transparent with that. We did go through our logs. We did not have a breach of any kind. This was not a hack. This was not a breach. This was data that, if you had the skill set, you could have viewed. Further, let's see, what else did I want to say on that? You know, like I said, just we want to be transparent because my highest priority is making sure people have confidence in our election system. I will also tell you that we didn't have secure information like a social security number, driver's license number. None of that was ever visible. You have to put in more personal data that only the voter would know to get to those screens and to any of that code. So we've shored that up, and yes, it's like when Microsoft has a problem with one of their software releases, you issue a patch, and that's essentially what we did, and it was brought to our attention by my opponent. So, you know, so we move forward on that, and I think I got all the things, so.
Tina, how did you discover that?
Well, first of all, My Vote has had issues since 2012. There was a great New York Times article in 2012 where My Vote was hacked into by a New York Times reporter in about 3 minutes to get access to this different data. So one of the things, again, I do believe that in the next 4 years, technology issues are going to be huge for the Secretary of State. We had a citizen bring to our attention, you know what, I think you can hack into this thing fairly easily. So we took a look at it, and you know what? It doesn't take much skill. It doesn't take much programming skill to be able to do it. You can download all 4.1 million data records and gain access to all of those data records very, very easily. You can download it now, not a problem in making that happen. And you have access to things that really could be vulnerable for folks. You, again, they're...
this is information that's available elsewhere.
No, it's not information that's available elsewhere. You cannot get to... in the voter rolls that you get, the information that you get. You're not getting people's private emails. You're not getting people's phone numbers. And then the reverse is true, where you can upload a different address. You can upload a different status in terms of ballot. You can upload all this other sort of information. Here's the issue I have most concerns about. Number one is, I don't see any evidence from the Secretary of State as to what she does every year in terms of cybersecurity. I've asked for, where's the cybersecurity report? Where's the firm that you work with? How does this happen? Number two is, we have a really great cybersecurity officer here in the state of Washington. I have to give props to Jay Inslee for this, for instituting that and having that there and taking it very seriously. Same with Michael Cockrell, who's the chief information officer for the state of Washington. The Secretary's office does not work with the cybersecurity officer around these sorts of issues. So what I'd like to know is, what's happened since? How have you tested it? How can you make sure that there isn't a breach or opportunity for a breach working through this? And you've said that maybe there were 1,000 opportunities that people had to go into the system. Well, you know, you can pull this data in a variety of different ways. You have a Republican presidential candidate going out there saying, the system is rigged, I'm going to lose because the system is rigged, there's going to be data hacking and all of that. We should be moving and working really hard to make sure that as a result of finding this, people feel incredible confidence in this. And you should demonstrate that through transparency in how you're dealing with the problem. I don't think that has been done, and I don't think that, we spend $1 billion on technology in the state of Washington. The Secretary of State's office has two systems, really, that they're in charge of in terms of voting and in terms of corporate registrations. And both of those, the attention to detail around making sure they're safe needs to be there.
So, so first of all, this isn't a new issue. It's not like suddenly we realize, oh, we have to secure all our data. We've been doing it for decades. And under my watch, I can talk to, we do an annual security audit. An outside firm comes in and tries to hack into our system, and then they give us vulnerabilities. So one of the vulnerabilities that came out after 2012 was all they were requiring initially on my vote was birth date and name. And then you could have changed records and done all that, and that was obviously not a high enough security level. So now we ask the voter to give us their expiration date on the driver's license, which is a more difficult thing for someone to get, and you know, and is higher level security. But with that said, we convened for all of the secretaries across the country a cybersecurity summit a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, July of 2015, at Microsoft. This is an issue that election professionals have been dealing with for many years. It's at the top of our list because, again, it goes to voter confidence. And it is interesting watching, you know, the both parties. It's not just Donald Trump. Hillary Clinton has also made some allegations that, you know, things could be risked. The strength of our system is that we have 9,000 independently elected and appointed officials who oversee our elections. And that decentralized system is a strength because, one, this whole idea that Donald Trump's, you know, saying that it's rigged and it's already decided, you'd have to get most of them to agree to, you know, ruin their reputations and change them. So it's on its face, it's not true. But we do have to instill that confidence. And, you know, we are constantly upgrading our system. We are constantly monitoring. We have more than two systems just in elections, by the way. We have a very complex set of not only our archives and library and corporations, but our elections system. And every one of those systems we're very conscious of. And we have layers of security that are not just electronic. One example is every tabulation system in the state is air-gapped from the internet. None of them are connected to the internet, so someone can't hack in and change that coding. In fact, I was just talking to my colleague in New Jersey, and he has gone through a trial where they were attacked for all sorts of things because a professor got one-on-one time with a voting machine, and he was able to show that he could change the coding and change the vote count. But he left out a lot of things out of the security things built in, and the judge agreed that, yeah, the system's fine and this isn't going to happen. So, you know, we constantly are aware of it. We're constantly fighting it. We have thousands of attacks every day to all of our systems. And I have a team in my office, and you're right, I don't have the cybersecurity team that works for the governor overseeing my stuff. I take full ownership and responsibility. I publicly will admit it when we're wrong, and I will be transparent and all of that, but I'm not going to risk the voter database. By the way, the voter database is not connected to my vote. Again, another layer of security. They are separate. We download a copy of it every night. So even if someone was able to get in and see whatever, they are not getting close to touching the actual database. And you know, we don't talk about a lot of security issues because we don't want people to know them. You know, that's part of the security. So, you know, to say that we have done nothing about cybersecurity is just patently false.
But so do you work with the cybersecurity?
Yes. Okay. Yes. But in terms of responsibility for the system, it is my staff.
Oh, and Tina, I believe early in the campaign, you had called for the state to not hold a presidential primary. Mm-hmm. But that's not under the purview of the Secretary of State, is it?
Well,
isn't that up to the legislature?
The legislature needs to make that decision. The Secretary of State is the one who needs to start and make the call in making that happen. Let's be clear about our primary system here in Washington
State.
Were
you aware that the Secretary could...
Absolutely. Okay. What I wanted to call out was essentially a little bit of hypocrisy here on the Secretary of State's talking about the primary and working through it. Look, in 2015, she sat at the Everett Herald, not once but twice, saying if the parties were not going to use the primary, she was going to call for it to be canceled the way it was in 2004 and the way it was in 2012 and save the state the $11.5 million that it takes to put on a primary like that. All of a sudden, her party now wants data to be able to work through the their party issues and partisan politics here, and all of a sudden the primary is back. Let's be clear, what the $11.5 million budgeted for the primary buys citizens in the state of Washington. It buys you three rounds of postage-free ballots in the state of Washington. It buys you drop boxes for every 15,000 county residents, as well as drop boxes on every college campus and on every Native American reservation in the state. It buys you the administrative costs of same-day registration and pre-registration for 16 and 17-year-olds, because the bulk of that pre-registration, Kim's only gone to 17, the bulk of that pre-registration happens between 16 and 17. And then it also buys you one thing that she promised, again, in a litany of broken promises when she ran in 2012, which is a statewide voters pamphlet in the primary, which is definitely information that most counties don't get. So here's the issue, and here's what we need to be talking about. what is the job of the Secretary of State? Is it to focus in on a partisan presidential primary, or is it to focus in on the needs of all the other citizens in the state of Washington and weigh those? Again, I called for my party and took the heat from Democrats to say we shouldn't be doing caucuses, we should be doing a primary. I've called for the primary to be earlier, and in fact, not just the presidential primary, but let's look at that August 2nd primary.
Well, Ms. Kinnear's called for that as well.
Well, she hasn't called for the August 2nd primary to do that, and the work around making sure to move the primary up didn't start soon enough in working through those pieces. So, you know what? There's an opportunity to look at this whole primary system, how we spend this money, and how we do this work. I've also said, and I'll close, with the primary, if it's going to be a party-identified primary, meaning only Democrats voting for Democrats, only Republicans voting for Republicans, having to do party affiliation the way we had to do on the outside of the ballot, which annoyed many people, then maybe we should do what New York and many other states do, which is have the parties pay for that primary, as opposed to all the taxpayers of the state of Washington pay for that primary.
Yeah, but Kim, hadn't you worked previously to move the primary?
Yes, so
the it wasn't there.
Yeah, so talking about the presidential primary second, we'll go back to the regular primary. When we were starting to move it from September, and I was still a county auditor, I testified that I'd like to see June or May. And worked with legislators, and they kind of laughed at me because, of course, you have to freeze. You have a lot of issues to work through, but I came from a state that had a June primary. It's very doable, and actually it would probably make our election cycle a little bit better. But with that said, yes, we started working in 2014 on language for the 2015 legislation, met with party chairs from both parties, and originally when I sat down with the ed boards, I think I sat down with all of you and talked. You know, the goal was really to incentivize both parties to use the results. And I had an epiphany as this process burned through and it wasn't about my party putting pressure on me to have a primary or not have a primary. It came down to, when we get to 2016, people are going to expect to vote on the primary. They're not going to want to go to caucuses. They're not going to want to do that. They're going to want to vote like they do in every other election. And my job is to provide that opportunity. And that was what we dialed it into. We tried to move it earlier to make it more meaningful. We had a language in the bill initially that if the parties, so to Tina's point, if the parties didn't use the results to allocate some of the delegates, then you know we wouldn't even have a party ballot. And of course, that bill didn't get passed. So you know, moving forward, we had an opportunity to move it up with a committee that was made up of the caucus leadership and then the party chairs and vice chairs, and it's a partisan committee, 4-4, and I'm the deciding vote. And we couldn't get along partisan lines, could not get the we need six people. I'm not the deciding vote. We need six people, and we could not get the party to move the Democratic Party to move the primary earlier. In fact, the state party chair in this open public meeting said it would confuse voters if the caucus and the primary were close to each other. Now let's look at what actually happened. 1.4 million people showed up when we already knew who the two candidates were going to be. Voters in the state wanted to weigh in. They did not, you know, less than 300,000 people went to caucuses. You saw how the caucuses were managed and what a mess they were. You know, caucuses lasting 12, 15 hours are problematic for anyone. And the idea of the parties paying for this, first of all, they wouldn't use their money for voter contact to pay for a primary, but even if we could get them there, that would get them a seat at the table, and that would give them the power to really define how that primary is run, rather than having it be an objective election like every other election that we conduct at the county level. So I would not entertain that idea. I think just the opposite. I think we bring back the unaffiliated ballot. One of the things that I heard from many, many voters was their frustration of having to publicly declare because they didn't want their boss to know their party affiliation or maybe someone at church or in their union or whatever. And I think in your profession, you have a lot of people that probably didn't vote because they didn't want, you know, their readers to know what party they were. So, you know, we need to bring that back, and we need to, and also I've been working with some of my colleagues in other states to try to have regional primaries and try to make that system a little less sporadic and get candidates to come here and not only raise money, but campaign. You know, they're not talking to our voters. They're just coming here and using Washington as an ATM. So, there's comprehensive reform that can happen around primaries, and we'll be doing that in 2017.
I think it's not off the table and shouldn't be off the table for parties to pay for party functions. Other states do it. There's no reason why we can't take a look at that and make that happen. New York does it, and there's no danger of parties being a part of the electoral process. They're paying for the function, and the function is done by the elections departments to make that happen. I think that the question here is, let's talk about sort of the partisan nature of focusing in on something like that to the detriment of making sure that voting is equal for so many other folks in Washington State. There's only X amount of dollars to be spent, right, in state government on these sorts of functions. What do you spend it on? How do you do the work? How do you advocate? I err on the side of, you know what, let's look at the equity of voting for each and every other election during that four-year cycle, and then let's look at what we can do, again, to not be spending this amount of money to the detriment of all of those other pieces, like looking at things like pre-registration and same-day registration for a presidential primary.
Yeah, and I do want to move on. Tina had mentioned your office tweeted out a story about Bill Bryan.
I would have to look. I don't know what the story is. Okay. Dave Ammons is the person that does our tweets, and he actually tries to do any kind of political stories. He's just trying to inform people of what's out there. So I can tell you that there's plenty of ones about Jay Inslee, and we're very cognizant of that. And so I'll have to look. I don't know what that tweet is about.
Wow. I'm really surprised, because the Secretary of State's office has replied a couple of times about that tweet today, and I'm surprised that you don't know about it. I mean, the reality is the Secretary of State's office is not using government resources wisely, or I believe legally.
Do they also tweet out stories about Inslee?
You know what? There's a difference between talking about, well, first of all, I wouldn't tweet out any of those stories.
Do they also tweet out stories about Inslee?
You know what? I don't know that they've tweeted out stories about Inslee of a political nature. You know, there's a difference between putting something out there from a government standpoint that Governor did X, then tweeting out a political puff piece on your party's gubernatorial nominee.
Now, I don't want the story. I can't
characterize it as a puff piece. I would urge you to take a look at that, because that's exactly what it is. But the problem is, why do this at all? Your role is not to be out there tweeting political stories. There's plenty of people doing that. Your role as Secretary of State and using government resources is to get people registered and get people voting, get them information about how they register their business, get them information about Washington State libraries.
But they have tweeted out stories about it.
You know what? I don't know, to be honest with you. I do know this one was illegal, and this seems to be a pattern of practice.
It's a pattern, but you don't know if they've tweeted out stories about it.
I would go back and take a look at that. My understanding is they have not tweeted out politically based stories that way, no.
Kim, would you do us a favor, when you get a chance to look at that tweet, would you get back to us?
Yeah, as soon as I'm done, I will do that.
Okay, thank you.
Great, we'll move on then. Give us your final pitch, why voters should support you. And we talked a bit about endorsements earlier. If you have any others you want to mention, now would be the time to do it. So,
sure.
Tina, why should voters vote for you?
Right. I mean, we could talk about it from the context of endorsements, because while Kim's endorsements are very narrow, mine are very broad, and they include voters around the state of Washington and people who are dealing with voters and dealing with equity issues. It's everybody from, well, all the former governors of the state of Washington, but also folks like Kate Brown. Probably when she was Secretary of State, the most innovative Secretary of State in the country, and now governor in Oregon, and of course the champion of automatic voter registration. But places like Democracy for America, places like that work with the African American community, like the Black Collective, or organizations that work with the Latino community, or Asian Pacific Islanders, folks that are chronically disenfranchised and underrepresented. I think there's a definite difference here in this race, and the perspective is different. Kim's is the status quo and everything's fine. Mine is that our system has been eroding over the last 4 years, and we can fix it and we can make a difference. I come at this job from 30 years of experience in government, in technology, in management, and in nonprofits. If you look at the entire job of Secretary of State, you're not an elections administrator per se. That's what the county auditors are doing. That's what the head of your election division is supposed to be doing and administering. You are an executive. You're an executive manager who's looking out for the voters of the state of Washington. And I maintain that my track record in working on initiatives around equity, my ability to work with the legislature, as a Seattle City Council member, to get various bills passed with Republicans and Democrats, my leadership for National League of Cities working on issues related to police financing and police issues, again, with Republicans and Democrats, shows the track record of being able to get things through the legislature that Kim has not been able to do. And it's been her own party not making that happen. I'll give you a quote from the last three sessions and three debates that we've had, which is I've not been able to convince the legislature. To me, that's been the motto of Kim's 4 years in office, and I know that I can do better. I have a proven track record there. I have experience in making sure that legislation passes. I have experience in managing to the numbers and the data. And the reality is you can't fix our election system here in Washington State unless you take the first step to make sure we've got comprehensive data, we're working on that, and we're transparent and accountable to getting that out there here to everyone. I think the voters of the state of Washington indeed have an opportunity to hire someone different in this job, and I do believe that I'm the person they're going to hire. So thank you.
So as I said in my opening remarks, this comes down to who do you trust to ensure public confidence in elections. And we all remember 2004, and you know, voters in the state lost confidence in our election process. And I've worked very hard for the last 12 years to rebuild that confidence and improve elections not only in our state but across the country. When you compare the experience and what Tina and I bring to this, it's not just about status quo. It's about understanding the technical nature of not only elections, but archives and library and corporations. When you talk about working with the legislature, I'm really proud of some of the things. You know, yes, I didn't get the things she's pointing out done, but you know what? We brought the Microsoft IT Academy. Now imagine, Microsoft IT Academy, which is bringing high level and entry level computer training to people across the state for free. We were able to stabilize the funding for the state library. We've worked with legislators on both sides of the aisle to solve some big problems, and it takes time. I mean, Olympia is a tough environment. It's different than the one that Tina worked in when she was in Seattle City Council. We have a pretty homogenous demographic of people who are running city government. So, you know, I'm running on my track record. You know, I helped build a data matching center called ERIC, the Electronic Registration Information Center, through a work group that I was involved with, the Pew Center in the States. And what we're doing is we have a consortium of 20 states. Our goal is to get all 50. But we're matching our voter registration list to find people that have moved from state to state, and quite frankly, even within state, and keeping our roles very accurate. And one of the things I'm very cognizant of in any policy decision that I make is not only having access, but having security, so balancing those two. So we've done the accuracy side with this. We also do outreach to people who we identify through this process as being eligible but not yet registered. And in the 4 years that we've been doing this, we've mailed to 1.5 million people in the state who weren't registered to vote. We've picked up about 160,000 of those people who have registered to vote. And I would remind you too, going back to an early comment that just popped in my head, you know, we've added 100,000, well actually closer to 200,000 now, new voters in my tenure as Secretary of State. But remember, for every one of those new voters, there are 4 to 5 transactions that are happening to keep the voter database up to date. Updating addresses, updating names, taking people who passed away off the rolls. And all of that work is part of this. So you can cherry pick out things like turnout. You can cherry pick out, you know, you look at the way this campaign is run. And I'll just close with this. My opponent is showing a very clear track record, willing to manipulate data to make a point, to talk about low turnout, to talk about the cybersecurity breach of 4 million records when that didn't happen, and throwing gasoline on the fire and being willing to risk voter confidence in our system to win an election. And like I said, I have been transparent. I will definitely get back to you on the tweet. And I do have a broad base of support, and I look forward to seeing your editorial review of this.
Great. Well, thank you to both of you.
Thank you.